1 Corinthians chapter 3, as we're looking through this letter that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth under the overarching theme, the perfect gospel for an imperfect church. We're still in the early portions of this letter where Paul has expressed his concern for division in the church. Preacher worship, if you call it. One choosing one preacher over another and thinking himself or herself more superior for recognizing the giftedness of Paul, some of Apollos, some of Peter. And Paul's not happy with it because he knows that the church is to be built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ, to rally around the banner of the cross and recognize people for what we are. Sinners saved by grace or sinners in need of grace. And so today we're looking at this subject, building on the foundation of Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 to 15. We'll see how far we get in this. If you would stand with me so we can read this, if you'll follow along in your Bibles. If you don't have a Bible with you, we've got the text on the screen for you. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 to 15. Remember now, he's still thinking about this matter of division, and it's going to become more plain as we get toward the end of chapter 3 in a week or two. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, but the day will disclose it. Because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. This is what? It's the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. May the Lord teach us today the importance to make sure the foundation that we're standing on Christ the solid rock, the only foundation of the church, Jesus Christ our Lord. And may we also be challenged to recognize the role that while Paul is talking about himself as a master builder, and he's going to speak about ministers, his use of every man and any man in this passage and the passage following lets us know that he's talking to everyone who names the name of Jesus Christ. All of us are building something. Let's make sure it's on the gospel. Thank you. Please be seated. Well, as I pointed out to you, that the discussion that began in chapter 1, verse 10, and carries all the way through chapter 3, verse 23, Paul is still involved with this attitude of an issue of divisions in the Corinthian church. But now he's come to talk about it in terms of what he calls the day. When you see this use of the term the day, in Hebrews uses this, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, so much the more. For you see the day approaching. He's talking about the second coming of Christ, being ready when Jesus comes. He's showing us in this how worldly and fleshly behavior and the spiritual division it causes affects rewards. A lot of people don't like to talk about rewards, and a lot of people abuse the notion of rewards. But we have to recognize that rewards are spoken of in the life of the believer. And he uses that very language here in the passage. But he discusses in this passage what one writer called the paradox of rewards. The certainty, none of us deserve them, but the certainty of rewards and the uniqueness, the individuality of them. Each of us rewarded individually. And the way he speaks about this, we need to be sure that we do not fall into the trap that some do of comparing ourselves to others, thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought, imagining that we deserve or should get a greater reward than someone else. That's not at all where this discussion is supposed to go. It's supposed to cut at the heart Now the remaining sin of selfishness, which manifests itself in this situation in Corinth in terms of divisiveness. Paul's, one of his motivations was to be found faithful when the Lord returns. Not the idea that he will earn his salvation, but that he will hear what all of us want to hear. What is it you want to hear at the end of the day? When all is said and done and all the voices around you speaking good and speaking ill have been silenced, what is it that every discerning, sincere believer wants to hear? Well, it's found in Matthew 25, 21, and again in verse 23. The master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master." Don't we all want to hear "well done"? Doesn't matter if 10,000 people tell us, while on earth, "good job," if at the end we don't hear "well done" from the Lord. By the same token, it doesn't matter if thousands jeer against us. And the prophets were considered utter failures by their generation, but I have no doubt, as we're studying through those on Sunday evenings, going through the looking at Jesus, seeing Jesus in all of Scripture, I have no doubt that the prophets one by one heard, "well done, good and faithful servant." Paul wrote to the church at Philippi, you remember this passage in chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead," listen to his language, "I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." Paul was not wanting glory to himself any more than you and I want glory to ourselves. Paul was not trying to prove himself better than other Christians, just as you and I should not do that either. But he wanted the Lord's highest reward upon his life. He wanted the victor's crown. He wanted to know his life had been pleasing to God. And that's what he's pressing on the Corinthians here. Don't think by lining up behind a preacher that you're pleasing him. Don't do it so that the preacher then tells you how pleased he is with you. So that's wrong motivation. Get behind Jesus Christ under the banner of the cross to know the Lord's pleasure. If we get to 2 Corinthians in the years to come, are you going to see some things in that letter where Paul sets forth in chapter 5 some motivations he has for doing his very best. And by the way, that's really what every Christian is called to do. We're not called to be better than someone else. We're not called to be more capable than someone else. We're simply called to do our very best. When it's all been said and done, did I live my life for you? When it's all been said and done, did I do whatever I found to do, eating or drinking, did I do it all to the glory of God? Did I give God my best? And so we see here just a few verses I want to show you. He wanted to please the Lord. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. He says, "So whether we're at home or away, we make it our aim to please him." Our aim to please him. You know, we live in a day of men pleasers, people pleasers, and it gets folks in trouble, and there's a lot of folks that bow to a lot of pressure. We need to cut through that as believers. Make it your aim to please him, that is, to please the Lord. And just a few verses down, he tells us that his ministry was controlled by the love of Christ. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:14. "For the love of Christ controls us," or constrains us, "because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all died." And if you've done a study of this, read commentaries on this, you know, the question is asked from time to time, because of the form of this, the love of Christ. Is it the love that Christ has for us or the love that we have for Christ? And the biblical answer, the exegetical answer, is yes. It's a chicken and egg thing. Because the Lord loved us first, we love him. And that's a controlling factor for us. Another thing pointed out in this passage in 2 Corinthians 5 is that he wanted to be part of something effective and effectual. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:15. He died for all that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Paul wanted to get in on that. He says earlier in 2 Corinthians in chapter 2, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphant procession and through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of Christ. For we are to God the aroma of death in those who are perishing and the aroma of life in those who are being saved. But see, thank God who always leads us in triumphant procession and through us spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of Christ. Paul was motivated knowing that he was involved in a mission that could not fail. And if you know the life of the Apostle Paul, as I think it was F.F. Bruce that wrote the book, The Apostle of the Heart Set Free, and he talked about Paul's magnificent obsession in that book, Paul didn't approach anything halfway. And by the way, neither should we as Christians. We need to give a warning. I need to give a warning to myself and to you. You know, the longer we journey with him, the zeal should not diminish. The zeal for Christ should deepen. It may manifest itself differently. I don't run as fast as I once did. I went out the other day and did something that I haven't done in a long time, maybe a long time before I do it again. I tried to play a little hockey with my 5-year-old grandson who loves hockey. Now, of course, we didn't do it on ice. There's not a whole lot of ice around here. But on concrete, and at the end of the day, I had a throbbing in my legs that I hadn't known in a while. I'm not young anymore. But that should not diminish zeal for the Lord. Look at Paul. Think about how Paul lived. 1 Corinthians 9:24 to 27. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? That's kind of different from the notion today, by the way, where everybody gets a certificate for participating. He said only one receives the prize. So run that you may obtain it. And here, of course, he's not talking about running against to beat others. He's running to obtain the prize. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable one. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. And Paul says, I don't want to run in vain. I don't want to live in labor in vain. He uses that term from time to time. We've already looked at that in Corinthians. Unless you receive the word in vain. He wants his life and he wants the life of those in the church at Corinth to be a life that is not vain, but meaningful, fruitful, fulfilling. Because you see, Paul knew from Jesus what we read are the last words of Jesus. Revelation 22:12, when the Lord says, behold, I'm coming soon, bringing my recompense with me, to repay each one for what he has done. We said to you that all through the book of Revelation, there's these things about Jesus saying, I know. And to the believer who thinks he's struggling, unknown, unrecognized, those words, Jesus, I know your works, are very encouraging to one who struggles under the radar, who seems, could say to oneself, what difference am I making? Jesus knows. He knows your works. But it's also an ominous statement. We looked at this when we went through the study of those of Revelation and those seven letters. I know your works. Here, as the book of Revelation's closed out, to repay each one, he says, I'm bringing my recompense, my reward with me to repay each one for what he has done. Now, let's be sure that we understand this whole idea of rewards and judgment. If you've been saved by grace through faith here today, if you've been justified, that is, declared not guilty and accepted as righteous in the sight of God, not for anything that you did initiating in yourself, but simply your believing response to the person and finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, then your sin has been judged at the cross. You will never be judged in a condemnatory way for your sin again. But every believer will stand before a judgment, before the Bema. The Scripture teaches that. Look at a couple of passages with me. Romans 14:10, where Paul is in that practical portion of the letter to the church at Rome, where he's chiding them about how they relate to one another. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Why do you despise your brother? But we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. In other words, who made you the judge of your brother? You're going to be standing before the judgment seat of God just like him. 2 Corinthians 5:10 expands upon it a little bit. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Not salvation by works, never. But as Ephesians 2 says, by grace you're saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto the performance of good works, which the Lord has ordained that we should walk in them. So you have this. Works is not the root of salvation. Works is the fruit of salvation. And we will stand. We'll all stand before the Bema. And Paul has something to say about that. I want you to see in this passage here as we begin to open it up today, the grace necessary to build a God-glorifying edifice. Verse 10, the only foundation worthy of building upon, verse 11. The spiritual quality of the materials used to build in verse 12. And then the reality of divine judgment upon our work, verses 13 to 15. You see, Paul moves, remember in verse 9, we looked at a couple of weeks ago, you are God's field, you are God's building. He shifts from, as one writer said, from agriculture to architecture. In fact, this notion that the grace is necessary to build a God-glorifying edifice in verse 10, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation. Someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it. This word master builder, if you could read it in the Greek, you would recognize the word architect. As a wise architect. Now, Paul is an archetypical master builder. No mere man could match him. He was incredibly gifted, set apart by God, authoring half the New Testament. But he is archetypical. He's a model for us. As pastors, as leaders, as members, he is a model for us. When he talks about this being a skilled master builder laying a foundation, he's talking about church planting here, how he went in to city after city after city. Preached the Gospels. Have you ever thought about the strategy of Paul? I was just reading back through this week, and it struck me. When Paul was converted on the Damascus Road, taken off into the Arabian desert, where the Holy Spirit turned him upside down in his Judaistic thinking. And when he got through with him, he was a first rank evangelical theologian, clear on the gospel, articulate on the gospel, able to put into context all the Jewish learning he had as a Pharisee to let it submit itself to the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. He came out of that. And he would go to the synagogues and preach. And more often than not, he would be kicked out of the synagogues. Now, if a Jewish background believer were to go into pagan society and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Jewish carpenter from Nazareth, what kind of a hearing do you think he would have gotten? Not much. But if a Jewish background believer, a Pharisee pedigree, goes into the synagogues and is kicked out of the synagogues, how do you think the Gentiles view him? They at least have that much in common with him, because they were despised in the synagogues, just like he was. And so Paul had this incredible church planting strategy. He would go and preach the gospel first to the Jews, and then rejected by them, he would take the gospel to the Gentiles. And he knew he did it by the grace of God. Paul was not a man who felt like he was chosen by God because he was because of how great he was. In fact, one of the great sayings he says in the pastoral letters is, I'm going to tell you something that's worthy of being received, and by implication, worthy of being repeated and told to all. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and I know that because I am the worst sinner ever. That's what he was saying about himself. And so he was not full of himself here. And he's trying to put into context for these Corinthian believers, I laid the foundation in Corinth. What we read in Ephesians 2, this built upon the apostles and the prophets, that is the preaching and teaching of the apostles and the prophets pointing to Jesus, the apostles revealing Jesus as the Messiah, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, the stone, as we've looked at before, that lays and marks out everything. It squares everything. And if it doesn't square with Jesus Christ, then it's not worth having. And he says other people are building upon it. That's the way it should be. Paul was not the type of fellow, and I've known preachers like this who would maybe begin a work and then lay a good solid foundation and then be protective lest anyone else try to build upon it. Paul was not that way. He recognized the reality. Just as he said in the agriculture analogy, one sows, another waters, God gives the increase. Here it's I lay the foundation, others are building upon it. And what's important here is not who laid the foundation, not who's building upon it. What's important for Paul is take care how he builds upon it. Take care how he builds upon it. We're to approach the advance of the gospel carefully, not haphazardly. A calling to the Christian ministry is a serious thing. James makes it clear that teachers will be held doubly accountable. You don't play fast and loose with the Word of God. You don't try to be clever. You don't try to come up with something new, the whole de novo mentality. We're called to be faithful. Faithful. The message, the faith once for all delivered to the saints, passed from this generation to this generation. If you know your church history, you know that there have been seasons in church history when the gospel flame was reduced to an ember. We've told you before, we're in the 500th anniversary. 2017 is the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation of the 16th century. In October, we will recognize that. There are conferences going on all over the country right now, evangelical conferences celebrating the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. But it was a day when the gospel had gone deep underground. And Martin Luther was raised up by God to say of that church that was so full of pernicious error and so binding people up and deceiving them, when Martin Luther said, I've got a controversy with what's going on. And he nailed his 95 points of contention to the door of the church at Wittenberg. All he wanted was a debate. I've told you that through the years. Martin Luther was not trying to start a movement. His heart was burdened by what he saw. He wanted to find out, do you folks see this too? Am I out of line here? I look at the scriptures. I look at the church. I don't see where the two line up. But God used that. That little flickering ember. The Holy Spirit breathed upon that. And it became a flame once again. And then a fire. And then a wildfire that swept across Europe. And we are recipients today, living in this country. Some don't know this. I like to talk about George Washington as the father of America, and he is. But as someone has rightly said, if George Washington is the father of America, and you look at the constitutional republic that was designed, John Calvin is the grandfather of America. We are direct recipients. You don't see much of it today in contemporary America, but it's there at the foundation. Direct recipients of the recovery of the gospel, which was the Protestant Reformation. Paul says, be careful how you build. You need to know this. Each generation, we're always just one generation from losing the burning light of the gospel. The gospel will never die, but it's gone deep cover from time to time. And so we've got to be faithful. Those of us who are adults, who are preparing to step off the scene, we've got to be faithful to the end and be sure we pass on the clear, burning, powerful gospel of Jesus Christ crucified and risen. This is what Paul's contention is with Corinth, by the way, is they're making much of people. Both ways. They're promoting certain personalities and they're defaming certain personalities. And Paul says, none of that. Recognize me for what I am. Recognize Apollos for what he is. Recognize Peter for what he is. In Corinth's case, Paul laid the foundation. Apollos, who was laboring there, had labored there, was building upon it. All that mattered to Paul and what he's saying, all that matters should matter to the Corinthians is how that is being built. And he would admonish the leaders there not to waste your time in party spirit, but to be sure what you're building. And we're going to see. Look at this again. Let each one take care. He doesn't say let ministers, let each one. Every believer is called upon to be a careful builder. The question I want to ask you today is, what are you building? We've talked through the years here when we've gone through times of controversy. What's in your bucket? You got a bucket of water to put out fires, or you got a bucket of gasoline to fan the flames of fires? What are you doing? Are you a peacemaker or a peace breaker? There's a day of accounting that's coming. People who thought they were clever will find out it's not so clever in the eyes of God. You don't toy with the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. He shed his blood for that. There's a notion going around. I see it among young people today. Well, I love Jesus, but I don't have time for the church. Then you don't love Jesus. You don't love Jesus. Christ died for the church. He loved the church and gave himself for the church. And so we've got to be sure that we're tapped into who Jesus Christ is, what he came to do, and what he would have us to do. And that's what Paul's talking about here. The second thing I want you to see in this passage is that the only foundation worthy of building upon, Paul having said that he laid the foundation, others are building upon it. Be careful how you build. Notice, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And when he talks about no one can lay a foundation, clearly there's a lot of other foundations that have been built. There are ministries all over the world today built on all sorts of things. Built upon some foolish notions, some noble notions. There are ministries built upon making America great again. That's not our agenda, folks. Our agenda is to call America to repent before God and trust in the only Savior of sinners. There are ministries built on social action, social justice, ethical concerns. There are ministries built on some of the craziest notions. Our friend Conrad Mbewe in Zambia is increasingly being called out by some of the Christian, so-called Christian culture in Zambia, because he refuses to embrace the whole health, wealth, name it and claim it, prosperity gospel, the the notions of people going around bringing folks back from the dead, and on and on and on. And Conrad's called it out for what it is. It's a false gospel. And now he's being called out for that. There's all sorts of ministries all around the world. A lot of different manifestations here. So he's not suggesting that you can't build on something else. What he is saying is that you cannot build with eternity in view on any other foundation than Jesus Christ. You see, when all is said and done for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ in the West, what is important? You can ask the question a lot of different ways. What do you have to have to be happy? What do you have to have to be full of joy? What do you have to have to be content? What do you have to have to have meaning? You see, Christians say, well, yeah, I know I need Jesus Christ, but see, when that but comes in, that negates what we just said about Jesus Christ. He must be the sure foundation. As we sang earlier, you're not standing on Jesus Christ, on the rock that is Christ. All other ground is sinking sand. I found this and I thought this, I think this was John MacArthur that wrote this. It says, Paul did not design the foundation. He only laid it. The only foundation of biblical Christianity is Jesus Christ. The foundation is not New Testament ethics, many of which are found in other religions, nor is it in the history, traditions, and decisions of churches and church leaders through the centuries. It is Jesus Christ and Him alone. In a sense, it is all of Scripture. I thought this was very good, considering what we're doing on Sunday evening, seeing Jesus in all of Scripture. For all of Scripture is both from and about Jesus Christ. The Old Testament predicted and prepared for His incarnation. The Gospels tell the history of His earthly ministry. The Acts, the history of His church in its early years. The Epistles are commentaries on His message and work. And the book of Revelation is the final testimony of His reigning and imminent return. Then MacArthur said this, which I thought was intriguing. What Jesus said of the Old Testament is even truer, if this were possible, of the New. He said, you search the Scriptures, and it is these that bear witness of me, John 5:39, which is where we're living. That's our theme verse to do what we're doing on Sunday nights. The foundation is Jesus Christ. You can build on other foundations. You can build others. And for all intent and purposes, they can look just fine. But I would remind you that Jesus gives a warning at the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount. Having preached through Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and he gets to chapter 7, and I've told you this before, that when you get to chapter 7, his use of the verb of command, the imperative verb, just intensifies. Almost everything he says in Matthew 7 is command. Judge not, lest you be judged. With the judgment you judge, you shall be judged. Enter the narrow way through the small gate. Listen to this. Think about the foundation. What is your foundation today? What is the foundation of your friends and loved ones, your neighbors? It may look fine from the outside. Because Jesus talked at the closing verses of Matthew 7 about two houses. Hear this. Everyone then who hears these words of mine, there he's talking about the sermon he's just preached, he's laid out a powerful gospel argument, his kingdom manifesto. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. Jesus will say in Matthew 16, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For flesh and blood did not reveal this confession to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed this. And I tell you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Jesus goes on to say, and everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them, the little word do there, I've told you before, it's a present active there, does not continue to do, does not practice them, in other words. Whoever hears these words of mine and does not practice them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, the same rain that fell down on the house on the rock, the same floods that came upon the house on the rock. And the winds blew, the same winds that blew the house on the rock, and beat against that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it. Brothers and sisters, if you and I as individuals, if we as families, if we as this family of faith, if we're not building on the solid foundation, the sure foundation of Jesus Christ, the eternal Son of God, who in the fullness of time came, lived among people as fully human and fully divine, never sinned, kept the whole law of God for his people, and in the fullness of time surrendered his life so that he suffered the punishment of sin that was due to his people, dying the cruel, shameful, painful death of the cross, bearing in his body our sin on the tree, enduring God's wrath for sin, rising 3 days later, conquering sin and death and hell and the grave, ascending on high and coming back in bodily fashion. If everything we do, if everything we plan is not built upon that, intentionally shaped by that, then it's shifting sand. And it will not stand us well when the day comes, the day of judgment, the day of wonder. Remember, Jesus had said earlier, not everyone who calls me Lord, Lord, this is in the verses prior to what I just read, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day. And we've looked at that passage many times before in the years past. The construction of it. Many will say to me in that day, in your name, we did such and such. In your name. What you learn from that, you learn several things. One of the lessons you learn is there are a lot of things that are done in the name of the Lord that are not done to the glory of God. And he only recognizes that which is done to his glory, which glorifies him, which embraces his gospel. We're going to be talking more about this whole idea of rewards as he moves into the passage, but I want to challenge you today. When he gets into the terms of gold and silver and precious stones, wood, hay, straw, I want to leave you with this today. What do you suppose you and I can engage in the time that God gives us until he either takes us home or comes back for us? What can we engage in that's in the category of gold, silver, precious stones? Well, there's a lot of things. One of the clearest things is disciple making. It's disciple making. It's being an intentional disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ who's committed to loving God and loving others and serving the world with a view to glorifying him by seeing others we love and those we serve become followers of Jesus Christ who in turn take up the mantle of doing the same, of loving God, of loving others, serving the world, with a view to glorifying God and seeing others come to Christ so that they will do the same themselves. That's gold. That's pure gold. Pure gold. I want to challenge you as we read through this passage. Look at it again next week, Lord willing. Take an honest inventory. What am I building? Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Let's pray. Dear Holy Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we look at this passage today and in Jesus' name, oh, we need, as we sang, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you every hour. I need you. We need your righteousness. We need your Holy Spirit to fill us anew and afresh, to burn off the dross that distracts us, to refine us, Lord, And help us to engage in the conduct of a disciple as a disciple maker. Because we know this, that when the fire comes, gold, silver, precious stones will not be burned. They'll only be purified. I pray for my brothers and sisters here today as I pray for myself. Oh, Lord, help us to be found faithful. May each one of us, as we come to the end of the journey, hear from you, well done, good and faithful servant. For those who are not yet followers of Jesus Christ here today, oh, I pray that they will see that there is a day coming. It's unavoidable. We can change our calendars. We can miss appointments. We will not miss this appointment. Oh, God, press upon these here who are not yet followers of Christ to confess him today as Lord and Savior with a repentant faith and be saved and begin the journey as a disciple, as a follower, loving you, loving others, serving those we want to see become Christians. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Thank you. Please be, if you'll stand.